PC World fans, Adam here with Gordon, and we're a little late on the Ryzen 7 7800X 3D review, but we're here now. Gordon, you have all the information. We're going to go through it. Obviously, it's been out for a couple weeks, and people have kind of seen all the goodness from all the reviews. Some people have it in hand and are already gaming on it and having some fun. But we do want to go through and get the testing results that you got, not just in games, but also in the full full testing suite that you like to run through. So we have productivity tasks, we have light tasks, we have power to go over, things that aren't just gaming. So one thing to note real quick is that Gordon, you've included other CPUs in here. You have fresh results for the Core i7-13700K, but you're reusing the results for the 7950X, the 7950X3D, the 13900K, and the 13900KS that you just tested about a month ago, two months ago?
A couple months ago. Same version of Windows, same hardware, same motherboard, same GeForce 4090 card, and same driver, in fact. But it is a little older, and one of the problems with using Steam or any of the online games marketplaces is you can't lock a version down. So there may be some updates. Sometimes it's better to use an older game because older games don't change, so you're getting consistent results. Brand new game like Cyberpunk has pushed out several updates, and I suspect older results just aren't as valid as they were.
Okay, well, keep that in mind when we go through the results. First up is Assassin's Creed, and as you can see, it's an AMD win.
Yeah, I would say obviously the average FPS is not a big deal. AMD a little bit faster, but those 1% lows, the 0.1% lows, for both the X3D parts, not just the Ryzen 7, but also the Ryzen 9 X3D, I think solidly give it a nicer kind of livability than the Intel or the non-X3D parts.
Yeah, pretty close, but obviously, leaning AMD just a bit. But on the other side of the fence, we have Counter-Strike, and this one kind of always favors Intel, right?
Yeah, it favors those high clocks, the boosty score, boosty clocks of Intel, and, AKS has got the highest here. Interestingly, my K performance came out a little bit above the 900K, but honestly, generally Intel wins, but no surprise, it runs perfectly fine on the AMD CPUs. So
yeah.
I wouldn't say oh my God, gotta have Intel for that one. I would say it's not a big deal.
Yeah, definitely. All right, when we switch over to Cyberpunk, we can see a slight advantage for AMD, and for some reason that 7950X is actually the one that's pulled ahead.
Yeah, no, it's weird. Although the CPU is a little bit faster, and those were run on the same version of Cyberpunk. The Ryzen 7, the Core i7, again, as I said, was run on the latest version of Cyberpunk because you can't not run the game. And also the i9s and the Ryzen 9s were tested on the same version. And I think it kind of messed with the code when they pushed out all the updates for the path trace versions and all that, because my scores for the i9, I would have expected to be more in line with the i7, but for some reason, my i7 is a little bit faster. Remember, same video card, same drivers. In fact, that machine is the same build of Windows. It hasn't even changed, so a little confusing there.
Yeah, could be a game update. Yeah, okay, take it with a grain of salt. Also, this is with DLSS set to balanced and frame generation on. I would have liked to seen it without DLSS as well, but if you would too, let me know in the comments. Moving over to Far Cry, this one definitely likes cache.
Yeah, no, it definitely likes cache because both X3D parts are solidly winning. Look at that 7950X, it's behind everybody there. It's actually slower than the i7 here, which is not doing the best either. But the thing that people are really highlighting on this one is Ryzen 7 versus Ryzen 9, because you have the two CCD CPU versus the single CCD chip, and a lot of people suspect with Far Cry 6, basically the code is crossing over to the second CCD, and that may be slowing it down. Who knows? We do know, of course, it's AMD's hybrid construction to get that best of both worlds. Performance is still being worked on, but generally works here. Works better when you don't have a second CCD with vCache not on there. So, and they're of course both. I would say that 7800X3 is solidly ahead of the i9s, even the KS and the K parts. So, and my results for the KS and the K, even back when I was testing it, were a little wonky. I still haven't gotten to the bottom of it, but
for the KS.
For the KS, and this is going back and retesting it and doing many things to try to troubleshoot it. There were times when it was just a little slower than I expected, and there were times when it was perfectly where it should be. So.
Okay, all right. Moving on, we got Gears Tactics, and this one favors Intel.
Intel.
I guess more cores better because, I mean, the 8-core 79 or 7800X3D is definitely the lowest number on here.
It does make you wonder what is going on because I really suspect it's just the higher clocks, i9, K, KS. Again, see, look, this performance on the KS is kind of where you expect. It's just a pinch faster than the K. It's got a little bit higher clocks, giving you more performance. i7, much lower clocks than the i9s. Okay, that all makes sense.
Yeah.
Where it gets weird to me is on the Ryzen side, it's like, why is it slower than the Ryzen 9 7950X3D? Is it really core count?
Yeah, that is weird.
It makes zero sense, and believe me, I saw this immediately. I was like, what is going on? And I double-checked everything, and I am running it the same way, but for some reason, my scores are just simply so slower. It again makes me wonder, like, well, did they push out an update for Gears Tactics recently? I should have to go and see. And again, that is one of the problems using Steam or any online marketplace, because you cannot run the game without... there's no way to lock down the version like you could in the old days.
All right, moving on to Horizon Zero Dawn, another game that really loves cash, and this is a big win for AMD.
Big win for AMD, and you know that's a huge difference, right? And you're actually seeing basically margin of error for both the X3D parts, yay V-Cache, and they're both, you know, got a very decent increase in performance over that 7950X. And they thoroughly thrash the Intel parts. Again, there are some games that like Intel, and there are some games that like AMD, and this game likes AMD. So.
Yeah, definitely. Moving over to Metro Exodus, this one, I guess, favors Intel.
Yeah, well, it favors that K part, and again, that one stands out. And believe me, I ran Metro Exodus on the KS probably 40 times. There was just no rhyme or reason why that performance was as low as it was. In fact, look, it's basically the same as i7-13700K, and I don't know why. Honestly, I would say, you know, it's mostly a tie, but the K does outperform it. But that performance does make you wonder what is going on with this configuration. I would have expected the KS to be as fast, if not a little bit faster than that K part. So I would say you could sort of ignore the KS part and consider that those high clock Intel parts have a little bit of an advantage here. But again, you know, this is not enough to like, oh my God, I can't run this.
Yeah.
5% difference, who cares?
Yeah, definitely. Moving over to Shadow of the Tomb Raider with DLSS set to balanced. This one is another one where it looks like it loves the cache.
Yeah, again, both of those X3D parts look really, really good here. And they are. They are heads above all of the Intel parts and that non-V-cache 7950X. And it's one of those things that make you, basically, if you buy an X3D part, generally, you're gonna get pretty damn good performance, and this game is kind of one of those indicators.
Yeah, for sure. And it kind of looks like the same scenario here on Rainbow Six Siege. This one kind of scales almost the same way that the Shadow of the Tomb Raider did. So yeah, that's a solid win for AMD. Returnal, we've got a Epic preset and the Medium preset. Epic probably is GPU limited at that point, right?
Yep, that's why I cranked it down to Medium a little bit.
But the Medium one, yeah, shows a little bit more of an advantage for the cache, but it's still generally pretty close.
Right, it's still probably mostly a GPU limited game is my suspicion, even at Medium and at 1080p. So I think you won't really have to sweat it too much on the CPU, but clearly the X3D parts look a little better.
Definitely. The next one is Strange Brigade.
An older game, as Adam will point out.
It's hitting some sort of bottleneck here because those top four results are literally within margin of error. So, you know, we can't necessarily tell if Intel is winning on this one specifically in this configuration.
Although I will say, but the thing is why I think this is interesting is both of those AMD parts, as you can see, are at a disadvantage to the Intel parts, right?
The 16 core.
Like if you pretended the 7800X3D wasn't here, you looked at this, you're like, oh, okay, it runs a little better on Intel. But look at that Ryzen 7 7800X3D. basically right there with the end-all parts. And whatever the game is hitting, to me, it really says the single CCD X3D part is a nice win here because you're getting basically a game that seems to favor Intel a little bit, and the Ryzen 7 is running right there with it.
Yeah, moving on, I think we've got a couple more left. Watchdog Legion, wow, this loves cache.
Yeah, right? I mean, look at those big long bars for the X3D parts stand out, and the 1% and 0.1% lows are awesome. That's the reasons why people have been excited about X3D after the original 5800 X3D parts. The same excitement should exist for the Ryzen 7 and the Ryzen 9 X3D parts.
Definitely. And the last game that we have is World War Z, another scenario where it looks like it likes the cache. This one's not too bad. You know, we do have a couple other games that we're not going to get to, but it's just more wins for AMD.
Yeah, you've seen the videos, you know.
Yeah, you kind of know, but I think the other side of the coin we want to kind of get to here is obviously good for gaming. But on the flip side, you know, is there anywhere where the i7 is actually better? You know, what are you giving up by having that cache part? You know, oh man, it's only 8 cores. Maybe it's just not going to do as well in video editing or something like that. Well, you did a lot of testing for stuff that wasn't games. So let's dig into that now. Let's start with Cinebench R23, your favorite tool.
I get paid a nickel every time I run it. Not really, but it is easy to run. It is nice because everybody, again, they understand what it does. It's very predictable too, I think.
Yeah, and this one, under an all-core load, is obviously going to favor things with more cores. So.
Yeah, 3D modeling is always going to favor more cores, and Cinebench scales really well.
Well, and if we can look at one thing, the Ryzen 9 7950 X3D and the 7800 X3D, it looks about half.
Yeah, it is pretty much, again, you know, because, hey, it's got one CCD versus two CCDs. A lot of people got aggro over the 7950 X3D, and this proves why AMD made the 7950 X3D to me, because when you need more cores and it matters for what you do for a living, the 7950 X3D just is all over the 7800 X3D because it has literally twice as many cores. And also the bad look here, I think, is the i7 with that, you know, P plus E core. What is it, like 6 plus 8? It's just giving you way more cores, even though you've got a lot of those efficiency cores, than that Ryzen 7. And, you know, if we were to, the same problem for Ryzen 5, Core i5 as well. This is just simply not enough cores for tasks that needed, so. Well, you're looking at 40% less performance out of the Ryzen 7 versus the Core i7 here.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. And that's for multi-core usage. But what about single threaded? Obviously, we know the 7800 X3D has some of the lower clocks, but you know it's up there.
It's not bad.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Because again, remember Ryzen, the 7000 series CPUs was a big step forward for IPC. They also increased their power footprint. That really helped them a lot. But because that X3D part, remember, has that blanket of V-cache on there, they got to crank the clocks down. In fact, the clocks are even lower than the Ryzen 9 7950 X3Ds die with the CCD. And you can see, again, not to rub it in, Internet, but the Ryzen 9 7950 X3D, because it uses one die that does not have the cache, is giving you basically performance on par, a little bit better than the Ryzen 9 7950X. And you could see if AMD, you could sort of guess that if AMD had made a dual VCache version of the Ryzen 9 7950 X3D, the single threaded performance would probably be very much in line with what you're seeing out of the Ryzen 7, which again is not bad because again, they got a really good increase in IPC, but Intel solidly has a decent lead in, especially when you're pushing KS, where you're really pushing that power. KS and K way up there. And again, that 13700K is you know, doing pretty well there too. So.
Well, and we'll get to power later because we do have power charts for Cinebench. But moving on to Blender, this is another example of more cores equal better.
Right.
Right. And you know, we can kind of see that with the three different kind of scenarios that are laid out here. You know, but it's actually more of a win for AMD on the higher end core count than Intel.
We saw that originally with the Ryzen 9 7000s where they actually would outperform, you know, Alder Lake and Raptor Lake because they have nothing but P cores. even though they're using less power, they are still outperforming all of the P plus E cores that Intel is using, because Intel still is on an older process. They can't, you know, even they are using power, they simply can't get more power to the socket probably. So, I mean, definitely win for Ryzen 9 against i9s, but the green bar for that Ryzen 7 is, it's just not looking very pretty against that i7, because again, the i7 is 20, 30 bucks cheaper, and it is definitely going to outperform the Ryzen 7 in just about all things that matter, where core count is going to make a difference.
All right, moving on to V-Ray. This is kind of the same story, more or less.
Yeah, more cores are better. And again, we see where Ryzen 9 with 16 cores will outperform 24 cores of the i9s. We already saw that before, not news. There are definitely advantages for AMD with better process over Intel. Even though they have a higher core count, they just don't have the power to probably do it, I think. But when you're concerned about matching parts on price, Ryzen 7 versus i7, again, is, you know, it's 31% slower than that i7. So it's not pretty. Again, but, you know, 3D modeling is something that very much always, you know, fits in really, scales really well with core count.
Yeah, definitely. And kind of the same thing, moving over to Handbrake. This is shorter bar better.
Yeah.
I want to point that out. And more cores are generally better. I mean, even the Core i7 is beating that 7950X.
Right.
Yeah, is this somewhere where Intel, is it because it has more cores, or Handbrake favors Intel just generally?
Well, yeah, Handbrake is open source. Definitely, if you have more cores, it will use it, because that's why you're seeing very decent scaling, because the i7 is kicking the butt off of the Ryzen 7 easily. And also, you know, again, I would say Ryzen 9s aren't doing horrible. I mean, they're not bad. They're pretty competitive, actually. But you could argue, well, Handbrake's open source. I'm using SVT AV1 CPU encode, 10-bit encode. That's basically based on a codec that Intel did a lot of work on. So it's kind of like home court advantage, home field advantage. You could argue that. At the same time, if you're using Handbrake, which is super popular and free, and it's an awesome free encoder, please use it. You go with what's faster. And what is not fast is Ryzen 7.
Yeah.
And it's worth pointing out, because, you know, you know, definitely 3D modeling is fairly niche. Video transcoding, actually a little more common.
Yeah, definitely.
You're going to see this probably where you are doing CPU encodes, where more cores matter. And the Ryzen 7's 8 cores, it's going to have a hard time going against CPUs with more cores.
Okay. Yeah. Well, when speaking of video performance, we're going to move over to Puget Bench for Premiere. We have a standard run and the extended run. Let's start with the standard run. You know, and to tell you the truth, I actually expected that 8-core CPU to do worse than this. I did. I mean, obviously, Intel has that advantage with the IGP on the standard playback. So, I mean, that just take that off the table. But looking at that standard export score, you know, it's half the cores. So I thought it was going to be more like half the performance. It's not quite.
No, it's not. And, you know, this is one of the things where not everything is going to scale, because it's part of the standard export, but you're doing an export from within Premiere. Yeah, definitely you don't get the perfect scaling that you do with modeling, but you're still, if you're looking at standard export, which is probably going to lean a little bit more on the CPU than obviously the live playback,
yeah,
you're still looking at 26% slower than that i7 part, which is $30 cheaper. So you're at a disadvantage. I do want to point out the live playback advantage again is because QuickSync is used heavily in Premiere and also in Puget Bench, and that's why you're seeing it. And one of the other kind of weird things I'm seeing is the performance on effects and GPU score a little lower. I'm not sure why that is, because again, I'm using the same graphics card, the same graphics driver, and the same version of Premiere. So it's a little confusing. Something is going on there, but definitely not a... It's actually kind of what I expected, because I didn't expect it to be perfect scaling with the core count. But when you're still looking at an overall 35% and 26% for standard export score, clearly the i7 is going to be the better chip for Premiere.
Yeah, and we did do a video kind of digging deep into Puget Bench and Premiere runs. So if you want to go kind of see that and see, you know, where a lot of these scores are coming from, you should definitely go watch that. But for our workload, I do want to point out that, yeah, that IGPU performance actually does really help our workload here making videos, so right. it doesn't matter, you know, Intel kind of all the way for me. Let's switch over to the extended run, and it's actually pretty similar.
Yeah.
So,
similar, 31% yeah. overall depression versus i7, and 32% for the extended export score. Live playback, of course, again, that gets that typical beatdown because of QuickSync, 47%. The difference between this one and the other test is you throw in 8K media, so a little tougher.
Yeah. So I mean, either way, it's going to be pretty tough. But you know, it's actually not too bad. Not as bad as I expected. Moving over to another Puget bench, we've got Lightroom Classic. We have two different kinds of scores. One is active, we're actually moving around making right. edits. The other one is passive, which is batch exports. So on the active, I mean, that's within margin of error of the other AMD CPUs, so that's, you know, nothing. But it's really the passive score where things change. And, you know, I mean, it's got half the cores of the 7950X, but, you know, that's not too bad.
It's not too bad.
I would have expected for a straight export like this that it would have been worse, so.
Yeah, you know, again, it doesn't, you know, a lot of Adobe applications are far richer, far more complex, far more of a stew than we understand. It doesn't, again, perfectly scale with core count. But it's still, if you're looking at it, i7 versus Ryzen 7, you know, 19% is pretty, still slower.
Yeah,
right?
So, yeah, definitely.
And that, I think that really does come down to cores, because if you look at the Ryzen 9s, they stand right there with the core i9s. So core count is making a difference here.
Mm-hmm.
And the P plus E's, you're not getting as big wins and some other things, but 20% is still pretty decent. Active score, win for Intel, but I would argue that pinch faster is, nobody's going to really feel that.
Yeah. But I mean, I still lean more towards caring about active score more than passive score personally, but to each their own. And then I think this is the last Puget bench. We've got Photoshop. And this one is also pretty close.
Yeah, it's actually a much better showing here, because most things you do in Photoshop are very lightly threaded. There are some things, the neural filters that are in there, those are multi-threaded, but that is not part of Puget Bench script.
Mm.
You know, and actually overall, you're looking at, you know, 5% difference here between the i7 and the Ryzen 7. So it's really, really not that bad, you know. And honestly, I would say it's a wash. And that again shows you, you know, Ryzen 7000 was a big step up for AMD over 5000 for that increase in IPC and that power footprint. So they can be right there with some Intel parts. Even though Intel's a little bit faster, they're close enough that it's a wash for most people.
Yeah, but
overall performance.
To that point, I think if you would have had 5800X 3D numbers in here, it would have been definitely less.
You would see the depression, because 5000 was not, it's definitely not the same class as 7000.
For sure. So let's move over to even more lightly threaded stuff. We have browsing performance on Chrome. You've got three different things that test it. The top two paint kind of a similar picture, where speedometer definitely favors Intel. But those top two, I mean, the 8-core CPU is definitely the weakest, but, you know, 328 versus 347, not a huge jump.
Yeah, not a huge jump. You know, again, looking at Webex before, that's a longer kind of, you know, bunch of different scripted actions. About 7% difference. Not huge.
Yeah, 7%.
You know, that's a decent win for Intel. You're looking at Jetstream, it's about 6%, and speedometer about, you know, 7.5%. So, again, it's just going to be slightly crisper for Intel CPUs. That's what I say. I mean, it gets even better.
Slightly.
But I would say, can you feel it? I don't really think you can. You can feel it, but overall, though, you're just really seeing, to me, what it says is the Ryzen 7800X 3D just doesn't have the clock speeds, right? Because you just can't crank the clocks up like you can on a Ryzen 9. And the i9s mostly here are just ahead of everybody, because they're just gonna push those clock speeds really hard. The high boost clocks, that's why they're ahead of the i7. You are legitimately getting more for your i9 over an i7 here for your single threaded performance, because you're seeing it. Is it enough to matter? Probably not.
Yeah, probably not. Moving over to Crossmark, though, this kind of goes through and simulates a bunch of different things. We've got productivity, creativity, and responsiveness. Overall, the 8-core 7800X 3D is definitely the weakest.
Yeah.
By how much?
About 15% for overall. Okay. About 14% for productivity, maybe 11% creativity, and about 19.5% for responsiveness.
Okay, so
that's opening files and starting launching applications.
Do you think you would be able to feel that?
When you're kind of getting to 15 to 20%, it might be a little bit, but I honestly think, Ryzen 7000 is such a good CPU. Most people can't tell. If you were to sit side by side, you might see it open, 50 milliseconds faster. It's going to be a little bit faster. And the benchmarks don't lie, because it is just simply a little less snappier, right? Because i9s, again, are the winners here because pushing the clock speeds, right? And i7 actually does okay too. Ryzen 9 is overall not bad, frankly. So you're just seeing that you're not getting the high enough clocks. Is Ryzen 9 7950X non-X3D? Look at that. That's basically the best of the AMD CPUs here because it has that higher clock speed. Obviously, arguably, the hybrid design of the Ryzen 9 X3D is a little bit slower, not quite as fast, but it's so close, who cares? Mm. But again, that Ryzen 7, you're just not getting the same high clocks because it has the V-cache on there, and the clock speeds are limited because of that.
All right. Moving over to Office, something a lot of us use all the time. Procyon has a Office benchmark. In this one, it's kind of a mixed bag. We have Outlook that prefers Intel, even the i7 over the Ryzen 9. But Excel, that definitely prefers AMD, except right. for the 8-core part. That is still the slowest one on there. So it's kind of a mixed bag.
Mixed bag. And, overall, you're looking at, who cares, 5%. That's basically a who cares kind of margin. Word is, when you're looking at i7 versus Ryzen 7, 2%, who cares. Excel, 5, 6%.
Yeah.
But Excel is where, so the reason why you're looking at this, and Excel generally likes more cores. Mm. If you're doing some more advanced Excel workbooks, having more cores can help. And look, and again, you saw this with V-Ray, we saw this with Blender, where those 16 cores in Ryzen 9 gave an advantage, and we're seeing it here where it has somewhat of an advantage over the Core i9s. And you're also seeing that basically because it only has 8 cores and it doesn't push the high clocks, it's just kind of overall suffering versus all of them. The worst is in Outlook, where it's 14% slower than the i7 part, right?
You're gonna be 14% slower.
14% slower
responding to your emails.
That sounds like a lot, and again, I would say, it's gonna be just a hair, but you're not gonna feel it for most people. But benchmarks don't lie; it's clearly the slowest CPU here. And if you do kind of like overall kind of snappiness, you're gonna get that from mostly the Intel higher clock parts. The i7 does decent for the money. And then if you're going to go for big, giant workbooks where you're going to be crunching the numbers, Ryzen 9 is favored, or i9. And, that 8-core X3D part is not going to be fantastic. Not horrible, but not bad. Fantastic.
Not bad by any stretch. And then your favorite and mine, Geekbench, is the last benchmark that we have here. The single core score, pretty close to that i7. What's the percentage on that?
I'm yielding about 6% difference.
Okay.
What were we getting? Let's see what we got out of Cinebench. We were getting, for our single threaded performance, we saw better out of Intel i7 versus the Ryzen 7. It was 14%. Geekbench puts it closer. It's a little bit of a more aggregate benchmark, doing a whole bunch of different things. So it's about 5%, 6% difference. So
okay, but it's obviously that multi-core score that shows the 8-core CPU just kind of struggling to keep up.
Yeah, I mean, it's 33% slower than the i7, and it's 41% slower than the Ryzen 9 7950X3D, right? So yeah, if you put a lot of stock in what Geekbench does, it is somewhat controversial. I think it's actually a good benchmark if you use it correctly. If you're just going to argue about it on Twitter, then that's what most people use it for. It's not great, but it just shows you, again, 8 cores is going to let you down on those things where you need more cores, because clearly it doesn't have a core count. So
yeah, definitely. So like I said, that was the last of the benchmarks. We're going to get to the conclusion in a second, but the next thing we want to talk about is power draw. You did a couple different tests here. The first one is showing the i7 versus the Ryzen 7 with Cinebench R23 single-threaded.
Yeah.
And to tell you the truth, I thought the i7 was going to be a little bit more than this.
Yeah.
Because we definitely saw the gap between the i9 and the Ryzen 9 was very substantial.
Right.
This one's actually a lot closer than I expected.
Yeah, and again, that's because i7, you're not paying Intel the big money for those higher clock boosts. So i9 is going to give you the big clocks, that 6 gigahertz pretty number out of that KS part. You're not getting it out of the i7. It's basically limited because you didn't pay for it. That also means you save some power. So you're actually seeing, we have the averages here. The Ryzen 7 7800X3D was 112 watts. I basically clipped off before Cinebench starts and before it ends, about 112 watts on average. The i7 13700K, 119 watts. So I don't care. I really don't care. You know, I don't think it's a big deal there.
So one interesting way to look at it is that the i7 uses 6% more power, yeah, but turns in a score 14% higher. So
right,
that's actually, you know, I would call that a wash because obviously it's finishing sooner.
Right.
The Ryzen is taking a little bit longer. So this is actually a lot closer than I expected.
Right.
So.
And, you know, we didn't explain it earlier, but what you're seeing is a log of the actual power usage of total system. So total system, same graphics card, same amount of RAM, same SSDs, all the LEDs turned off, same power supplies. And you're basically seeing the test start and end and the continuous power being measured. So you get a feel rather than just some people who may just simply give you peak power. I don't want to just give you simple peak power. I want to look at it overall. And that blue line that stops sooner is because it's faster. It's done faster.
Yeah, it's true. But it's a little bit different when we move over to an all-core workload. The chart definitely looks a little bit different. So
yeah,
the i7 is obviously doing more work. It rendered 23 frames versus the 13
right
on the Ryzen 7, but it's also consuming 370 watts of power on average versus the 172 on the Ryzen.
Right, and I do want to mention the way I test i7 is the way I feel most consumers are going to test it. You install your i7 into your motherboard, the BIOS goes, oh, what kind of cooler are you using? Oh, you're using a liquid cooler. We're going to set the power limits for you automatically. In this case, it is essentially uncapped power limits. Mm-hmm. So Intel has published stock PL1, PL2. Most motherboards that are of any worth anything are going to ignore that and go for high power limits, which you can set the letter of the law power limits and get a little less performance. It's not as bad as you think it is. Or you can go with the way I do, which is I think how most consumers are going to end up with is an uncapped i7 in a decent motherboard with a water cooler.
Okay, and then what was the to look at it again? What was the performance?
It's about 41% faster for the i7 versus the Ryzen 7.
Okay, so it was 40% faster, but it used 73% more power to get there. So you know. Obviously, you know, if I mean, it's the bigger bar is better for sure, but it's definitely using more power to get there. So, you know, it's a trade-off.
You're using more power.
It's a trade-off.
And then, of course, you also have to balance if you're a 3D renderer and you need to render something and you need to be done so you can do your next thing, get onto your next job, make more money, it might be worth that extra 30% more power, right?
Yeah, so. Definitely. And then you did total system power. So obviously this includes GPU, motherboard, RAM, all that kind of stuff. You did it for Puget Bench with Photoshop. Obviously this is a more lightly threaded.
Right.
But once again, it's actually pretty close, pretty damn close.
Yeah, I was actually kind of surprised. I thought it would. I mean, I guess it just again shows you on lightly threaded tasks, it's not that bad for Intel Raptor Lake, right? Because you're looking at 150 watts for the i7 versus 126 watts average. Again, I'm clipping off the ends in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see where the Intel part will spike up to very high boost clocks.
Oh, yeah.
And eat a lot of power. You know, maybe that's also pushing more cores. You're also maybe, you know, Photoshop does use a little bit of GPU, but it's actually not quite as bad as I thought it would be because, you know, at the same time, you know, the Ryzen part is only 5% slower, but you're saving a decent amount of power, but I don't know if I would really start crying about 25 watts.
So the score is 5% lower on the Ryzen 7 versus the i7, but the i7 uses 17% more power, so, you know,
yeah.
Interesting little data point. But either way, I mean, this...
And I like doing this because I think people need to understand when you're using something that people would consider CPU-heavy, Photoshop, it's very lightly threaded.
Yeah.
And you're not using... If you're looking at a Cinebench all-core load for a CPU, that's often not what you're doing on a machine.
Yeah, for sure. So, yeah. And then, of course, you're going to look at total system power for a game, which is obviously going to paint a different picture because a lot of this wattage is obviously that 4090 in there, right?
Right, right.
So, and we're looking at an average of 420 watts versus 390. So, yes, the Ryzen is more efficient under this game load.
Yeah.
But, I mean, either way, you're around 400 watts on the wall, so.
Yeah, I mean, your GPU is just eating so much power, I think, for most gaming. I don't think the CPU is going to make that big of a difference because it's just I wish it was being used more, but it just isn't most of the time. So I used to use Metro Exodus for this, but I decided to try Shadows of the Tomb Raider because I know Shadows of the Tomb Raider runs wonderful on the X3D part. I mean, you're looking at what 35% more performance, 35% higher frame rates out of that X3D part, and less power, which is the good thing, right? Because you're using less power
and less heat.
And you're getting 35%, you know, more performance, but actually in overall system power consumption, it's not as horrible as you think it would be. So, because most of it's the GPU, but still, you're using less power and you're getting 35% more performance. So that's all kinds of wins.
That is all kinds of. I mean, but you already know that. You know, everyone else is kind of talking that's the big win. So,
right.
You know, that was kind of. What we wanted to come in here and look at was kind of the other side of the story as well. But the very last thing we're going to look at is your popular thread scaling. So what are we looking at here, Gordon?
So we're basically taking Cinebench R23 and running it one single thread all the way up to the maximum number of threads available in the CPU of the highest core count here, which is the Core i7-13700K. That's 8 performance cores plus 8 efficiency cores versus the 8-core Ryzen 7. That's all performance cores. And I like to do this because often, you know, we used to just look at single-threaded performance, we look at multi-threaded performance, and we don't care about what's in between. Some applications may use 8 cores, some applications may use 10 cores. You may be running multiple applications using 4 cores and 8 cores, and you might see that mix. I kind of want to see what you're going to get in the middle here. And it's kind of a fun little exercise. I have no idea if it's any use, but for me, I just kind of love seeing it because you sort of see where the CPUs race away from each other sometimes.
Yeah, and in Cinebench specifically, there is no one area where the Ryzen wins, but you know, up until about 4 cores, it's pretty close.
Yeah,
and then yeah, just kind of Intel starts to take away with it, especially at that higher core count where obviously the Ryzen just doesn't have as many cores.
Yeah, and that is, I mean, it's a legitimate real weakness. You saw this in the benchmarks. We saw this in real-world applications where sometimes 8 cores is not going to be enough. Obviously, for gaming, it is plenty. Honestly, it probably will be for quite a long time. But, you know, I think for the application side, there is a legitimate argument for having more cores giving you more performance if you need it.
And the next one is comparing the Ryzen 7 to the Ryzen 9. So this one is kind of comparable, but it's a little different too, because as it gets to about 8 cores to 14 cores, it actually kind of dips before it comes back up again. Either way, the 7950X3D in Cinebench is...
Yeah, I mean, no surprise when you have 16 cores for a Ryzen 9, it's going to easily wail on an 8-core Ryzen 7. This is still a very interesting exercise to me because we have, you know, basically two hybrid CPUs. Well, we have one hybrid CPU versus the straight up X3D part. And it just gives you a really good feel for what you're going to get out of the CPUs. And for me, why it's interesting is the Ryzen 9 7950X3D, I really felt a lot of people didn't get it, why it was made. And I think this kind of shows you because there is a performance increase because if you took basically, you know, two stacked dies and you put them in a Ryzen 9 7950X3D and they made what the internet asked for, you would be losing that boost to your performance on the left-hand side of that chart because you know, you're looking at, there's nothing to sneeze at where the Ryzen 9 7950X3D is, you know.
Always 13, double digits.
It's always double digits ahead. Yeah, 10 to 11% single, you know, lightly threaded performance, not huge, but that is definitely a more performance that you're going to get out of that non-stack part on the Ryzen 9 7950X3D part, which is what AMD, you know, that was your justification for making it. And clearly, of course, on the right side, no surprise there. But to me, the left side really sort of justifies it, because if the Ryzen 9 7950X3D had both stack parts, it would probably be dead even right up to you get about. Then it would only be till you sort of get to the, you know, greater core count of the Ryzen 9 that you would run away from it.
But yeah.
They would have given up, you know, double digit 13%, 14% performance on the Ryzen 9 CPU already might be at a weakness against the Core i9. It would have been even worse. So I think that's why this is interesting to me, because the Ryzen 7, again, is a fantastic gaming CPU, but it doesn't have the high enough clocks to sort of compete with the non-stack parts, or sometimes with the Intel parts too, right?
Yeah, and there were some instances where the 7950X3D lost to the 7800X3D in gaming, but it wasn't 10% across the board. They were typically right up there.
Yeah.
With it, obviously the 7950X3D cost more, but if you need those extra cores and you need that extra power,
yeah,
that's why it's there. But for gaming, you know, I think we can kind of get into the conclusion here. For gaming, that 7800X3D is pretty damn nice.
It's really...
for that price.
Yeah.
It keeps up with all those bigger ones, and a lot of the times, it actually beats them, so...
Yeah, you know, I mean, to me, that's... I mean, everybody... I kind of wish it would get to the price of the 5800X3D. I don't think that's going to happen.
Maybe.
But, I mean, honestly, even so, the magic of it is like, look... We have a Ryzen 7 part that's $450 that runs with Intel's pricier i9 parts.
Even in gaming.
It's KS and some things.
Yeah.
And that is all kinds of win for gaming. And that is what AMD was shooting for with the CPU. And I think they've kind of hit it. I think the CPU itself, like the 5800X3D, it kind of proves that there may actually be this interesting game niche where people, they only care about games 90%. That's their entire 90% workload is games. That's the only thing they care about. Your go-to part is going to be a Ryzen 7 7800X3D, right? There are some games that, yes, Intel's going to run better. But overall, I would say it is clearly I would agree with all the hype we've seen already that it is the best gaming CPU right now. With the Ryzen 9 7950X3D as kind of like that really close second CPU that gets you a lot of the goodness out of the Ryzen 7, but of course kicks its butt in multi-core performance.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
You kind of pick what you want.
Well, and then on the other side of it, if we compare the Ryzen 7 versus the i7, I think coming into it, I expected the i7 to lose to the Ryzen 7 in gaming. We kind of already know that.
Yeah.
But I thought on the flip side, for application performance, heavy workloads, that the i7 was just going to hands down run away with it, and yes, it was better, but I feel like it was almost a wash, like for the productivity stuff versus the gaming. Yes, AMD was better over here, Intel was better over here, but they kind of evened themselves out, except for when you needed all those cores in like a Cinebench or a Handbrake or something like that.
Right.
When you needed all those cores, you needed all those cores, and that's where the i7 really ran away from the Ryzen 7.
Yeah, you know, I will say, I actually did not expect the i7 to lose as badly in gaming as it did. Because I honestly think it got beat up pretty badly by the Ryzen 7 in gaming. I mean, again, it runs, it's like an i9 or better sometimes. I thought it was going to be a lot closer. And it really, a lot of the sort of the slower clock, the lower frame rates kind of shocked me on the i7 a little bit. But for me, the way I would kind of weight the decision is, it depends on how I use my computer.
Of course, yep.
Right, so if I'm going to be, again, if you're a 90% gamer and the other 10% is browsing and downloading torrents.
Or maybe even light Photoshop work.
Light Photoshop work where it isn't like, yes, your life does not depend on you spinning out a render. You know, the Ryzen 7 just makes so much more sense.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, if you're like, you know what, I game 50% of the time, the other 50% I'm doing Adobe products for, because I have Creative Suite, I'm paying, it's still awesome. I'm doing Lightroom where it is snappier. I'm doing Premiere where quick you get quick sync, you get more cores. I'm doing Handbrake encodes. I'm doing, you know, maybe some light modeling for my indie movie. The i7 is going to be the better general part. Because, you know, your weighting is like, now I'm more favored to general purpose and gaming. The gaming is not so, again, i7 is perfectly fine for gaming, and especially if you're playing at higher resolutions, then it doesn't really matter that much. But I think it really sort of depends on how you construct your day. 90% games, 10% browsing, Ryzen 7 X3D all day. You know, 50% games and you don't care as much about it, or you play at high res, and then the other 50% is I do work stuff on my i7, then the i7 is the better part, I think.
I think it's close. I think it really depends on how
well,
you slice
it. Well, but it's how important gaming performance is versus saving 40% on a 3D render.
For sure.
I mean, that's a huge amount if you were a 3D renderer and you're working at home on a machine.
Oh, right, for sure, yeah.
Or an encode where you're saving 30%. You know, that is a, when you're talking about taking an hour and you're shaving a third of it off, then that's nice. And then the quick sync. So there are advantages to it.
Definitely.
But I think you just sort of have to weight it based on it. But I definitely think for most gamers, and that is actually a very large part of the market where they really just want to play games with the RGB and they don't care about anything else, Ryzen 7 all day.
Definitely. Well, thank you for doing all the testing. I'm glad we finally got to it. Thank you for being patient and waiting for Gordon's testing. Now you can finally make that decision.
Oh, yeah.
Just kidding. You've been waiting for this video. Thank you again for watching. Be sure to subscribe here on PC World for more PC hardware and software goodness. We will catch you next time. Bye.